So, Rick versus the Doctor. If you know me, you know that going into this episode, I was somewhat excited, though not to the extent that a lot of the people around me were. Never watched Rick and Morty, have no interest in it, honestly still don't even with this episode. The Doctor though, man, Doctor Who has to be on my, it has to have been on my to-watch list for like half a decade, if not longer now. I've experienced a lot of two of the big three of live-action sci-fi with Star Wars and Star Trek, and short of the Foundation novels, there's no big part of sci-fi to match Doctor Who that I've yet to check out. I wish I would have had time to go and watch some Doctor Who, but I have so much on my plate right now. But with that said, I was very excited to see how they go about this. Almost as excited as I am to talk about today's sponsor, G Fuel. Don't skip it. Don't skip. Okay, well, if someone was going to, they would have already skipped by now. This video is sponsored by G Fuel, your all-in-one gaming energy formula devoid of calories, sugars, and carbs. Made with plant-based ingredients in a variety of 50 flavors and full of antioxidants and vitamins, it's at least complex multiversal for you versus debaters out there. Arguably even straight up outiversal, depending on what your definition of outiversal is. Available in cans and tubs, each one applying at least a 4.5 vigintillion times multiplier on their attack potency and speed, this is exactly what you need to be a gamer of the epic variety, such as yours truly, seen here thrashing some noobs as Rick Sanchez in Fortnite. Use the link in the description and code BLOODRIKE for 20% off your order of G Fuel, which does contain caffeine, so make sure you drink responsibly and only if you're over the age of 18. Okay, so for all you sodding wankers that time traveled through the video to get to this point, I can't even be that mad because at least it was thematically appropriate, and as we all know, being thematic is all that's important. It should be no surprise I'm not a big fan of them not giving any epithet for the characters after name dropping them, but I don't really care that much, and I'm honestly just glad that I haven't seen anybody make a huge stink over it. Wonder why that's not the part that they decided to make a big stink over. So despite what little interest I had in Rick, his analysis is actually pretty good. It wasn't starting too interesting to me, it was just a lot of, here's all this shit. But when they actually got to his story and what was going on, I was like, huh, that's interesting. The actual conceit behind Rick's character and why he is the way he is did for a second make me want to watch this show until I saw all the other stuff that was just kind of gross and weird, and also my knowledge of the seasonal incest arcs. It's by no means like unique to Rick, but that sort of like quantum nihilist is an interesting concept to me. It was a good analysis, and I actually kind of liked the cutaway. I know I can't say I laughed, but I cracked a smile, which is genuine. It's so hard to say this without sounding condescending. I like the cutaway, okay? Boomstick's childish response to what happened, like to what Wiz said, that made me smile. I liked it. I also predicted the dummy would make his return, so that's cool. Still not credited though, that's odd, and he also sounds kind of different. And of course, I love the Doctor's analysis. I mean, I was looking forward to this more than even the fight. That's how much interest I have in Doctor Who. And it was great, they covered their story really well, and at least the parts that I was particularly aware of in the War Doctor and Time Lord Victorious that were included. Obviously, with so many years of history, they could only go over a fraction of a fraction of what Doctor Who's gone through. What the Doctor's gone through. But the War Doctor and Time Lord Victorious are like the most well-known to me. And they also went over the origins well, without mentioning the chronologically avoidant infant. They also did good on focusing on the character and how they differ but always remain the same in all incarnations. That was cool, and I liked it a lot. Of course, I have to mention the editing as usual. This time in particular, it was the first full project by Galaxy Video Max. Wow, I know so many people who didn't but now do work on Death Battle. And I'm not one of them. Seriously though, he did a really good job for his first main go, and there are a lot of cool edits, comic panels brought to life, as I love to see, and generally it was a really solid job. I mean, we even got this newspaper, which is so sussy barker, it's not funny. Oh, Among Us. Also, I'd be inclined to say that the Doctor's cutaway killed Dummy for good, especially with how he's not being credited anymore, but Dummy survived worse, I think. Hey look, Fortnite and Fall Guys. So basically, Rick's analysis made me interested in him, and the Doctor is one of my favorite analysis in the season, honestly. Though almost certainly out of sheer bias. What we need now is a clean fight to bring it home, and oh hey look, it's hand-drawn! Wait a minute, yup. Two hand-drawn episodes. Back to back, two in this season. Neither of them was Bill Cord. And I'm happy about that, because Bill Cord was peak. And while I don't think this one honestly looks quite as good visually as Courage vs. Scooby, I just think that that's not honestly because it looks bad, I don't know how I feel about the way that which the Doctor is drawn in this fight. I don't know, something about the way like he's, and maybe his proportions or something, it doesn't do it for me, but that might just be a me thing. Just like last time, the hand-drawn elements are very well composited into the 3D backgrounds. I think maybe only this shot of the Ricks running through the hallway didn't quite look right to me, but I can't quite put my finger on why, so, eh. But like, otherwise, the fight looks great, and Rick looks pretty clean. I can't say for certain whether or not he looks straight out of the show, as I can only comment on clips from the analysis that I've seen, but he looks straight out of the show to me, but definitely don't take my word for it. I haven't spent enough time, like, I haven't watched Rick and Morty, so I haven't got all that time to have all the particular attributes and elements of the design singed into my head the way I did with, like, Discord and Billcord. But hey, he looks good. I am also glad that one of Rick's first actions in this fight after hooking onto the TARDIS is telling his ship to keep Morty safe. That was a nice character moment. And hey, look, there's Space Hawaii. I assume some of these planets around here were also seen in Manhunter vs. Surfer 2, if I was to wager. I guess before we go on from visuals, I'll also say, wow, the wormhole the TARDIS goes through at the start looks beautiful, I love it. I would kind of also love how after the TARDIS appears, they have a scream as if Rick's gonna fall straight down to where the Doctor is, but no, it's a sentient sun. And the Doctor, loving all life, even likes this abomination straight out of Cool Cat Saves the Kids. Then we get the reference arcade. So let's unpack all of this. Off the bat, we get arcade battle, showing off Killua vs. Misaka. There's cameo drop, which contains a bunch of cameos as seen in Bill Cipher v- Is that me? That's the me pony that was cut from Billcord and brought back in the Twitter updated special edition version of this scene. Pretty fucking based, I love it. I also think these might be some of the other cameos that got cut showing up too, which is also great to see. Appreciate the love, fellas, whoever put this in, thanks. We got Techno Warrior referencing Rocket vs. Stitch, Ants in My Palmer, which has Raymond's death, you'll love to see it. Look, I mean, it's Billcord, plus a reference to the reference in this fight back in that episode. Columbo the Cura Files, you don't get points for figuring that one out, and of course, a Bill Cipher reference. We also later get a better look at what's said on this cabinet, which I think, using my incredible deductive powers of zooming in and hoping I got it right, says, "That's right, Boomstick, your favorite death battle is now under your control. Unleash your favorites in one-on-one mayhem." We also get a better look here at both me and also Biffweed and Red Runner and some of the other cameos. We can also see some other cabinets for the death battle fighting game in the back, showing us Raven vs. Phoenix, Martian Manhunter vs. Silver Surfer, and Blue Ranger vs. Sailor Mercury the DBX. I quite like the little banter here too. Rick actually gets a good line and we get a reference to the Spoon Sword fight. And you know, it looks really clean and is well done. The Doctor is clearly showing himself to be highly skilled, though a bit absent-minded, while Rick is honestly kind of just swinging wildly. The next shot has a goaded air hockey table, fucking love air hockey, and Monster vs. Godzilla standing beside 2000/Mega Gyrus Godzilla. I wonder if that's a reference to anything in the future. We also get this shot, which, okay, so let's look at this. We got Thomas the Tank Engine, probably from the DBX. Mikasa and Blake finally just talking it out instead of randomly coming to blows. This. Harley and Jinx clearly having a therapy session. Alex Mercer and Obito Uchiha having an ill-fated edge-off. Auto Ving jumping in the cack, yeah. Darth Vader celebrating his birthday all alone because nobody loves him. Maybe Obito put him back into the Infinite Tsukuyomi, so he's being gaslit into thinking his wife's sitting there with him. There's Freezer and Megatron, with Megatron looking to be propping the table up on his petite little leggies. Liam, Skyrim, and Dimitri hanging out there having a drink, and, you know, Guts is also standing there in a puddle of blood because, there's also Cole you can see trying to succeed in a spin to win, probably failing though. And hilariously, nobody is moving, except for Guts' cape. Also, there's the Milano. We see here, wait a minute, I recognize that video. Yeah, that shot wasn't just some random shot of these two Godzillas, that's SX123's Godzilla and Godzilla 2014 SFM video. Holy fuck, does that person work on Death Battle? I didn't know that if they do. They did the coughing baby versus hydrogen bomb animation that some of you might have seen before. That's such a random reference. I mean, that's cool though. Hey, Death Battle, if you ever get another situation like this and you ever want to put a reference to a not Death Battle, like a Cool Cat versus Optimus Prime in the background, you got my permission there. Mm-hmm. There's also Gojo versus Makima and I think a DBX in the back. So yeah, anyway, the actual fight part, not the references, is also fun. Doctor disarming Rick and Rick grabbing him with the grabby ball feely arms. Which, you know, it doesn't work because get Sonic Screwdriver, loser. But it's a cool little back and forth, I like it. Then, like all good contraptions do when they malfunction even slightly, the cybernetics explode! We get a really cool bit where they fall through two dimensions with the second one being full of weeping angels, which I think is a cool reference because the one episode of Doctor Who I've fully watched is Blink! And it's amazing! Which is clearly a hint for Doomsday vs. 682 because these guys like that one SCP. I also kind of like the Doctor just lying to get Rick killed. I mean, technically, Rick, I don't think if I'm remembering correctly, he wouldn't die. He would have all like the time eaten out of him. The blinking first person shot is also pretty cool. I say that like getting all the time eaten out of you wouldn't basically kill you. The shot of all the Ricks fucking up the TARDIS is pretty amusing, but I particularly like how the Doctor is genuinely confused and worried for the TARDIS, but then notices, oh, just the one discrepancy with the actual room he thinks he's in, and that's all it takes to be able to use this to his advantage. The TARDIS goes out of his way to aid the Doctor, I like this little note on the wall, and I particularly like how when the Doctor brings out the fuck off death gun, he hesitates to actually grab it. He doesn't actually go through with using it at all, which in most situations, in most death battles, you might be thinking, you've been trying to kill this guy all fight, why hesitate now? But if you notice, the Doctor never actually throws an attack at Rick, aside from this little yonk with the spoon that's barely noticeable. It also might not be attack, I don't know, you barely see it. Throughout this fight, the Doctor has tried to just leave Rick alone, then he was ready to fight but mostly just defended himself from Rick's offense, then he really just deactivated Rick's equipment without directly attacking him. He did a funny to get him fucked up at Weeping Angels, but again, didn't actually attack him directly, and only now is he ready to actually attack, and he goes straight for the big guns too, but he still hesitates. But even then, he doesn't get to, as Rick just pops up from his back and shoots him to death. Almost. The Doctor does his regeneration, and it looks so good, and it goes so well with the swelling of the music. I even understand his reference. I get what the "I don't want to go" line is referring to, though the context here is pretty different, but I like it. I don't necessarily know why he's like, "The one thing you never understood," as if Rick has known him for more than 2.5 minutes. But fuck it, I quite like Rick realizing he's not gonna make it, and his contingency plan is to shoot the chestburster gun at the Doctor. That's pretty good. And the kill being him trying to shoot the Doctor with his own fuck off gun, but the Doctor using the portal that was already on his back, combined with the portal that he used the Sonic to create by firing off Rick's own gun into the distance to redirect the blast back to Rick. That's pretty great. Like, come on, you can't deny that's pretty fucking clever. Not only is he again avoiding directly attacking Rick, but it also implies that he had a contingency plan ready for just in case Rick was able to get his hands on the gun and attack him during regeneration. The Doctor was fully aware of his weakness and planned ahead in case Rick survived and tried to take advantage of it, both in case his own gun was used and in case Rick had another gun ready in advance, both of which was the case. Then all the Ricks die and we go back to the start of the animation just without Rick. Weirdly enough, Rocket's satellite isn't there anymore, which makes me wonder, did he actually go back in time to when the fight started but now Rick is gone? Or did Morty happen to end up exactly where he began and the Doctor showed up after the events of Stitch Rocket but before the events of Manhunter Surfer? Like, is the order of events, first there was the start of this fight, then Stitch Rocket happened, then the end of this fight comes in, and then Surfer Manhunter? I don't know. Also, Rick showing up to haunt Morty is amusing, though I have no idea if he can actually do that. It's a creative ending to a fairly creative and entertaining fight that play well into the Doctor's pacifistic nature. It's a very fun, very characterful, and very unique animation that played well into their arsenals and crazy shit. In particular, I just want to note again how good the wormhole and regeneration look. They're beautiful, and as far as my un-Rick and Morty trained eye can observe, Rick looks pretty much straight out of his series. It's visually great, the interactions are cool, the choreography is really neat, and it's really creative once you catch onto it. I think it progresses well, and I also really like the track. I refuse to say the name of it, but it's a good track. However, where I'm a bit unsure of is the voice acting. Now, I don't mind Elliot Crosley as the Doctor. Is it Crosley or Crossley? I don't know. Which should be no surprise, as they are a David Tennant impersonator who has even officially voiced the character in that incarnation in Doctor Who Lockdown. However, I'm just not feeling Brent Williams' Rick Sanchez. That might just be me, but I don't think it was a horrible performance, and this was their first time on Death Battle to my knowledge, and I definitely don't want anybody to go after them just because I wasn't too into it. No one should try to bully them off the series just because I don't like it, because I'm sure a lot of people like the performance. Personally though, while the voice sounds like what I know of Rick, I just don't think a lot of the deliveries work for me. Something about them just don't do it. The opening line is weird, the inflection in his second line sounds off, his pre-attempted kill line also just sounds kind of off to me, and the pause was just weird, and his final line also doesn't really do it. His quip when whipping out the sword though works for me, and the other just like random lines and sounds, they also work well. I don't think it's awful, I just think maybe the direction wasn't there, or maybe this is accurate to Rick and Morty and he just naturally sounds this off, in which case, that's more reason for me not to want to watch the show. Again, it's not a bad performance, it's just one that didn't really work for me. The conclusion was actually quite unique. It went through entry by entry with title cards, which I don't think has happened since Goku vs. Superman back in Season 1. I'm sure some people will protest to them not using the Doctor's most impressive speed and strength feats, but those people protest too much. Though it is odd that I don't think they mentioned the power of the regeneration explosion. That's about all I think was missing, maybe? I guess it's not a huge deal though, because I really like this conclusion. I don't know if I want all episodes to go about it this way, but this is a lot more concise and clear-cut than normal. It flows well, and it feels like it brought up everything of relevance. There's no surprise the Doctor won, but I'm not complaining. Though I do hope that Rick and Morty fans weren't too bothered by the community during the waiting period. So we have here another Season 10 banger. Two pretty good analyses with great editing and writing, a really fun animation that's visually gorgeous and has very bopping music, cool choreography, and a fun vibe, and a very solidly concise conclusion. It might not be one of my favorites of the season overall, but I think that says more for how good the season is as opposed to how bad the episode itself is. Great work on it, everyone, and thanks for the cameo! Whoever put that in, if you're watching this, you can comment down below and I might not even see it at all. Hey, well, hope you guys enjoyed that. That was the review for The Doctor vs. The Funniest Thing I Ever Saw. So, yeah, I hope you guys enjoyed the review. Hope you guys really enjoyed the episode. I am actually very happy with how it ended up. I keep saying things like that as if I'm on the team. I'm not. I am in the episode, though, I guess, so you never know. But yeah, maybe tell me what you guys thought about the episode down below. And if you want, you can support me on Patreon. Thank you to all the ones who, all the people who are scrolling by on screen right now. And if you do that, you can get to the Patreon only Discord where you can make me say some absurd bullshit. That was not a planned burp. I don't know how you plan. I guess you can fake a burp. Let's see what they want. What do they want me to say? Wubba lubba dub dub. More like wubba lubba dead dead. Oh, I'm so good. Rick, I don't think you can beat him. Like he is too strong, man. I don't know Morty's voice. That's the fucking thing. I'm just going into his Shaggy voice when I try to do that.
You don't seem to understand, Rick. I've lived several millennia in this TARDIS. Every day I eat, sleep, Fortnite, and repeat in this phone booth. Nah. I win.
Biff, for once, see, Biff keeps trying to make me do this, but, like, for once he's actually managed to, like, send it before I've recorded this bit. I can't do a Homer Simpson impression. Like, what does he expect me to do? What does he want from me?
Under the sea, there'll be no accusations. Just friendly crustaceans.
Is that what he wants? I don't... You confuse me, Bavid. A broken tree stump in my neighborhood. That's true.
We might have lost.
Now, that is just not acceptable. That is offensive. Like, I am offended by Homestunk. Homestunk? Homestunk! Homestunk! Fucking hell.
This is a story about four people named Everybody, Somebody, Anybody, and Nobody. There was an important job to be done, and everybody was sure that somebody would do it. Anybody could have done it, but nobody did it. Somebody got angry about that because it was everybody's job. Everybody thought anybody could do it, but nobody realized that everybody wouldn't do it. And it ended up that everybody blamed somebody when nobody did what anybody could have done.
Stupid Morty! You made me look back. I can't do a Rick voice. I can't do a Rick voice.
I'm pickled AM!
You fucking happy? You fucking happy? Is that what you wanted?
Bingle bongle, dingle dangle, yickety doo, yickety da, ping pong, lippy tappy too ta. You do the hokey pokey and you turn yourself around. That's what it's all about.
Oh god, recite the Doctor Who vs. Doc Brown rap. Can I remember this? Rap battles of history, Doc Brown versus Doctor Who, begin. Oh, actually, if you don't mind, it's just the Doctor. It doesn't even really matter. Who am I even talking to? Oh yes, you. The wannabe Einstein, minus the stash, travels through time, but with no class. I'm living the world while you dilly-dally. You can't even invent your way out of Hill Valley. Calm down, will you? Everything's going to be fine. You're not going to tear any wonky holes in any fabric of space and time. Actually, it's more like a rug, really. Never mind. Let's just say there's an infinite number of me simultaneously kicking your ass with rhymes. Great Scott, you're great!
Nah!
I spit it hot, and I generate way more power than 1.21 gigawatts. I'm not sure what kind of scientific authority you purport to be, but I'm a real doctor. Where'd you get your degree? Despite all your companions, you couldn't be having less sex. I don't know what's lamer, your fans or your special effects. You don't even get another term to debate. Time to face your permanent fate. Dalek my balls. Exterminate.
I'm going to die. At least this version of me. Perhaps you'd like another. Prepare to meet your...
density. Now, I'm a mystical medical doctor at the pinnacle shifting my physical form. You're a possibly pedophilic individual who should have never been born. You got your knickers in a twist while you're sucking on my Piccadilly, but I'm a lot different. Cause you're a pitiful hillbilly hanging with an edible kid who's a bok-bok chicken. Nobody calls me a chicken. This is between us, Scarfy. Don't try to out-rhyme me. You'll find I'm as grimy as any slimy time limey. And I'll use your porta-potty time machine as my latrine. You're not a cat with 9 lives. You're a pussy. With 13. Who won? Who's next? You decide. Epic. Rap battles of history. Doc Brown versus Doctor Who begin. Oh, actually, if you don't mind, it's just the Doctor. That was so fucking stupid. I regret life.
Oh, that was the last one too. I could have just like ended it there and pretended like that came in too late. Son of a...
Alright, well, I mean, if you guys enjoyed that, then you've got more problems than I do. Yeah, you can go... I don't know if Biff's gonna do a review for this episode. If he does, I will link it in the description. If he does not, cry about it. But don't, and don't you go, don't you, I see you going around making your little comments and your little jokes. Where's the next review, Biff? Biff, when he doesn't do a review, is so funny. It's not, you're not funny. Take it from an authority on how not to be funny. You are not funny. Stop that. I see what you, stop, don't do it. Okay, good. So, hope you guys enjoyed the review. Have a good one, everybody. I'll see you next review. Yeah, have a good one.